Hello students, welcome to the class on editorial decode, and in this class I will be decoding why the Jayalalitha case matters, written by R.V. Acharya. Now from examination point of view, this will help you in general studies mains examination paper 2 plus. This is important for public administration and political science optional students. Now what is the context of this editorial? This editorial relates to disproportionate asset case that was filed against Jayalalitha and her allies. Now the verdict of this case has come after the demise of Jayalalitha, and in the verdict the court has put forward that the case against Jayalalitha is no longer relevant and the case has abated. Now this is the verdict, this is the decision of the Supreme Court, that the case no longer remains relevant. And it is on this aspect that this editorial has been written by R.V. Acharya. Now according to R.V. Acharya, this is a kind of aberration, this is a kind of a dereliction on the part of the court to come out with such a verdict. Because if you are deciding that the case against Jayalalitha has abated and that case relates to disproportionate assets case, and the assets that were disproportionately amassed by Jayalalitha had not been taken back by the state, and those assets are being enjoyed by the heirs of Jayalalitha, so in such a case, according to R.V. Acharya, the justice seems to be having not done. So this entire editorial revolves around the issue of justice and corruption. Now when it comes to corruption and when it comes to taming of corruption, it is the duty of the judiciary that it must set up good precedents. Now when it comes to this specific case, this specific verdict of the Supreme Court, the case doesn't exhibit the sign of setting up a good precedent. Rather, it had set up a very, very bad precedent. Now why it had set up a bad precedent? Because like the example that has been given by RVHR in the editorial, that suppose somebody is committing a lot of corruption, and after doing this entire corruption, after indulging in misfeasance, malfeasance and forfeasance, somebody just ends up committing suicide, and in that case the assets that would have been disproportionately amassed by that person would certainly be used by somebody who would be the heirs of the property of that particular person. So in that case, indirectly by giving such a judgment, the court is actually trying to promote corruption. So this is an indirect logic that comes out, because in such cases the court should be very strict, the court should be unearthing the issue and the root of the corruption, and it must try to uproot that root of corruption, because if that is not being done, in that case a situation or atmosphere will be created whereby the people will not fear of the law. Now a law should be very much strong when it comes to the cases like corruption. Law should not only sound strong, but law should actually be strong. Its conduct, its substance should be real, it should be substantive, and it should be forceful. But in this case, like the verdict from the Supreme Court, it seems that the law at the face seems to be very strong, but when it comes to its implementation, but when it comes to the adjudication process, the adjudication specifically in this case, it has remained short of what the law of the land actually had wanted. Now this editorial also relates to a gap that courts generally adduce to. Now what is this gap? What is this hiatus I'm talking about? The hiatus about hearing up all the arguments, and after hearing the arguments from the parties involved in the case, giving up a verdict. Now the courts, they have developed a tendency to actually reserve the verdict. Now this again creates a kind of a confusion in the mind of the people, and the people who just want justice from the judiciary, that this period, this gap, this hiatus between hearing the arguments and pronouncing the verdict should be done away with. And this will actually make the entire judicial process fast. Now, had the verdict would have come before the demise of the Jayalalitha, she would have been declared a convict in the particular case, and the asset that she had amassed would have been taken back by the state. But that is not the case now. Now, the case against her has been abated, and by abating such a case, we're just trying to create an ameliorating condition, good conditions for the people indulging in corruption. So this was all for the editorial decode. You can subscribe to this channel. Name of the channel is BrainyIAS. You can contact me at 845-940-0000 in case you're interested in buying the video classes on entire civil services preparation and in order to join offline classes. So this was all for the day. Bye bye. Take care. Have a nice day.